Hi everyone, this is Dr. Diksha here. Welcome to the next video in the series of A to Z of Pathology. Today we'll be talking about two letters, D and E. So let's begin. The first letter, the first word I've picked is desmo. Now the meaning of the word desmo is actually a knot or a bond. It's from ancient Greek. And then if you add a suffix to it, then you can, you know, create different kinds of words. For example, desmosome, as I'm sure all of you will remember. Remember that the term knot and bond in medical language is basically something that connects, you know, the bonding, the knotting, it connects, so connective tissue. So if you can remember this, we can derive new words from this. For example, this is an electron microscopy photograph of a desmosome. The word "some" means body. So the knotting body. So this is the body that is knotting or bonding two cells. So desmosome. This is a tumor called desmoid fibromatosis. Desmoid fibromatosis, as the name tells you, is a fibrous tissue tumor. So you can make out a lot of connective tissue. And the term desmoid is just to again convey that it has a lot of connective tissue in it. Next, I want to talk a little bit about a very interesting finding that we get in malignancies. Now, what you see here are two sorts of things in this photograph. The one in green, the one in black is showing you tumor cells, okay? So let's assume this is a breast cancer specimen, a photograph, and you can see cells, you know, which are invading into the stroma. And if you can make out the ones marked with the green arrow, the stroma is reacting to the tumor cells that are invading. Hence, this is a reaction, right? And what is happening in the reaction is there is a growth or a formation of connective tissue. So the term we use for connective tissue is, the term we use for growth is plasia. And since it's connective tissue, I will use the word desmo. So I will call this the desmoplastic reaction or desmoplasia. This is a very classical finding in a malignancy. This is the reason why the tumors when you palpate are firm and hard. And this is why when you see them on gross, you use the term gray white on, you know, description. So this is desmoplasia or a desmoplastic reaction. Next, I'm sure you can make out from the photograph and the term, the word dacro. The term dacro basically means teardrop. And again, we can add suffixes to this term and come up with dacrocystitis, dacrocystography, derived from the lacrimal gland, or of course, dacrocytes, which is the RBC shaped like a teardrop cell. So here in this photograph, I'm sure all of you can make out the teardrop cells, right? Now the question is, why would these form? Imagine the RBCs are trying to leave the bone marrow and they are trying to come out, but there is some architectural issue in the bone marrow. For example, imagine that there is fibrosis in the bone marrow. So if there is fibrosis in the bone marrow, the RBC, when it's trying to come out, it will get distorted. Something like, you know, don't leave me and go, and you know, so it starts to cry, something like that, if you can remember it like that. So it becomes distorted and that causes the change in the shape of the RBC. The second reason why you could get a teardrop cell would be, say it is passing through the splenic sinusoids and there are macrophages which recognize that something is wrong with the RBC and they try to, you know, either eat them, or if they contain something abnormal, they're trying to remove them. For example, say there are some inclusions, like you can get abnormal tetramers of, you know, leftover globin and thalassemia. So whenever there are some inclusions, the RBCs, in the RBCs, the splenic macrophage will be trying to remove them. And in that attempt, they can distort again the shape of the RBC. So remember, myelofibrosis, and anywhere that you have inclusions, you can get teardrop cells. Next, I want to talk about two terms, endo and exophytic. Endo and exophytic. The endo and exo, the phytic term basically means growth, and endo means on the inside and exo means on the outside. Now these are for, especially for the PGs, remember these are very important terms used for gross description of any malignancy. Is it growing endophytically? Is it growing exophytically? So this is a diagram I found which will be helpful to you. You can see that exophytic means it's coming outside and endophytic means it's growing within the wall of the whatever the organ it is. And if it was growing, just to add one more thing for you, if it was growing like this, then you would call it diffuse. So it's everywhere. So you can use three kinds of gross descriptions. exophytic, endophytic, diffuse, right? Next, let's look at this term that I'm sure you'll recognize even from gynecology, effacement. I mean, sorry, obstetrics. So, effacement. So this term effacement basically means it's French for to obliterate, to wipe out, or to destroy. It basically means remove the face. So to obliterate, to wipe out, or destroy. This is a term that we use when normal architecture is lost. It's lost its face, it's been destroyed, it's been obliterated. And of course, if you guys remember from, like I said, obstetrics, you'll remember effacement of cervix in labor. But in pathology, there are two places where we classically use this. One is effacement of lymph nodes. As I'm sure all of you know, lymph nodes have a nice cortex and then a medulla. And if I cannot see this, if this has been destroyed, if something has come, or you know, this pattern has been changed, I'll call it effacement. If it has been obliterated by big nodules, I'll call it a nodular effacement. If it has been obliterated by something diffuse, I will call it diffuse effacement. Next, the term is used in kidney, effacement of podocytes, right? And as I'm sure you will remember, if podocytes lose their foot processes, the other term we use here is there has been loss of foot processes, then of course there will be a problem with the filtration, the slit diaphragm will be lost, and you'll get massive proteinuria. So to make you understand this effacement, let me show you a couple of photographs. This is a normal lymph node architecture. As you can make out, all of these are follicles. All of these are follicles, secondary follicles, since I can see a germinal center in the mantle zone. This area is all your paracortex, and here you have the medulla, and this is the capsule, right? So this is a normal architecture. Now look what has happened here. Can all of you make out that in this lymph node, I cannot make out any cortex, any medulla. So this is a diffuse effacement, since whatever has happened has taken over diffusely. So we use this to describe lymphomas. We can use this to describe the presence of necrosis in a lymph node. So diffuse effacement. Next, I want you to look at this electron microscopy. Now, you know what we see here is this is a capillary. Right? So, sorry, this is the capillary, and this side, what you see is the endothelial cell. Here is all the mesangium, and here are your podocytes, right? Podocytes with their foot processes. Now, remember, this is, you see 3D in 2D. Never forget, in pathology, you are seeing 3D in 2D. So, the podocytes sit over the capillaries. Imagine your palm coming out, and you know all the fingers are the podocytes. So it depends on what section you'll take, whether you'll see only the podocytes foot processes or the entire, you know, podocyte. So what you see here is, if you can make out, see, this is the basement membrane. I'll use another color to highlight for you. This is the basement membrane. So what I drew here, this is the basement membrane. You can see an endothelial cell here. This is the endothelial cell. There are more you can see here this side. I haven't drawn them there. And then you can see the foot processes and the podocytes on this side. So foot processes, you can see them very clearly. And this is the mesangium. This is the mesangium, right? So I hope you're oriented. What was this? This was normal. This is absolutely normal. Now let's look at something abnormal. Look at this photograph. I'm sure all of you can make out again. This is one basement membrane. This is the other basement membrane. These are endothelial cells. These are endothelial cells. And if anyone can make out, this is an RBC. This is one RBC and this is the other RBC. Don't forget, we're looking on electron microscopy. They are sort of hugging each other. Can you make out? It's like their biconcavity has fixed into each other and they're hugging each other. So these are two RBCs. These are the basement membrane, and look what has happened here. Can all of you make out that we can't see the foot processes? They have been lost. So I will call this effacement of foot processes. And if I were to tell you that this was a child with, you know, massive proteinuria, edema, and light microscopy of the renal biopsy is absolutely normal, I would come up with the diagnosis of minimal change disease. Again, ask yourself, there are two photographs in front of you. One is normal, one is abnormal. I'm sure, again, all of you can make out with me. This is the basement membrane. This is the basement membrane. This is the endothelial cell. Here, there is some part of the endothelial cell. Here I can make out an RBC. Here lumen has no RBC. But if you look outside, here I can see intact podocytes, foot recesses. And here they have been lost. I cannot see the foot recesses because the podocyte has just lied down. It's lost its foot recesses. Hence, we will call this effacement. We will call this effacement of podocyte. So I hope this electron microscopy photograph is clear. And if you look at some more photographs of electron microscopy of the renal, which I'll cover in another video in some time, you guys can make out what else is wrong in the kidney. Next, let's look at this term ectasia. The term ectasia basically means dilation, right? So you can make out the dilation happening here. And if you add a prefix to it, you'll be able to tell what is wrong. So we use the term duct ectasia in breast. As I'm sure all of you will remember, this is characterized by a greenish brown discharge. And I'm sure you remember from medicine and otherwise that this discharge basically is indicative of infection. It's indicative of infection. And the second entity that you would have heard of is bronchiectasis. Again, if you break down the word, bronchi ectasia, so dilation of the bronchi. And last is telangiectasia. If you look at the term tel means end, the term angi means, or angi means vessel, and ectasia. So the end vessels are dilating. This is a very classical description that you can also use in basal cell carcinoma. You know, the surface has pearly papules and you can get telangiectated vessels. Very classical. But let's look at two more photographs. First is a duct ectasia. As you can make out, this is a normal duct. These are normal ducts, but look at this duct here. What has happened? You can see that the duct is dilated. You can also make out, I hope all of you can make out, the normal duct in breast is bilayered. It has a epithelial layer, it has a myoepithelial layer. So you can make out two cells, you know, lining them. And then within this, you can see lots of macrophages and lots of debris. So what has happened is because of the ectasia or the dilation, which is very commonly associated with smoking as well, there is, you know, like dilation and stasis. And anything that dilates a tubular structure, when dilates, the secretions inside them become very slow. And stasis is then going to lead to infection, which is why the discharge that you get here is greenish brown in color. Look at this photograph now. This is a lung specimen, a very well fixed lung cross specimen. And again, here you can make out that there are dilated bronchi, right? And when you're grossing a specimen, you can trace them, you know, all the way. If you put your scissors inside, you can trace them all the way up to the pleura. So they go all the way up to the pleura. It's a very classical way of figuring out whether there is bronchiectasis. And the problem here again will remain the same. There is inspissation, and it becomes a horrible vicious cycle: dilation, inspissation, infection, dilation, destruction. And of course, it's an effect. It's commonly associated with anything that causes an obstruction. Could it be a foreign body, tumor, atelectasis? But for exam going, PG exam going students, there are three syndromes this is classically associated with: cystic fibrosis, as I'm sure all of you remember, but also your situs inversus valla syndrome, Cartagena syndrome, and Young syndrome. Next term is emia. Look at this. You can make out the term emia means anything that is in blood. So you add a prefix to it, you can septicemia, anemia, and means absence, which is the literal translation of, you know, low oxygen carrying capacity, no blood, anemia. Leukemia, white blood, WBCs, tumors. So if you add the suffix emia, you can have viremia, hypovolemia, toxemia, anything. So emia, remember, we are talking about in blood. Last word is echino, echinocyte. And echino word basically comes from sea urchins. This is the family of sea urchins, Echinada, Echinida family. And what you see here are spinous projections, again spiny, prickly. But what you can make out is that they're very regular. They're not irregularly spaced. They are not uneven. So the term I'd like you to remember here is they are regular and evenly spaced, which is very important to differentiate it from the other spinous thing, and that is acantho, which I have covered in the video starting with A. So the term we use for RBCs, which look like this, are called echinocytes or bursels, and they're classically seen just if there is some sort of dehydration, like a crenated RBC, but like an artifact. But in, as far as pathology is concerned, it's associated with uremia, kidney diseases, any kind of lipid disorder, because this happens when there is not proper incorporation of lipid in the membrane. So this is an electron scanning microscope photograph. You can see such evenly placed, you know, projections. So if you would rub your hand over it, it won't prick you the way the acanthocyte would prick you. This would sort of make you feel really nice, like you're getting a nice massage in your hand, you know. And here, if you notice, you can make out these proper, evenly spaced. Remember, these are regular and evenly spaced. So these are echinocytes. You can go back to the video on acanthocyte of A and have a look at that and compare the two. So this was the letter D and E. Please subscribe, like, share Pathodoodles, and I hope you're liking this series. Please let me know in the comments. All the very best.